Majority Report with Sam Cedar, where every day's casual Friday. That means Monday is casual Monday, Tuesday, casual Tuesday, Wednesday, casual hump day, Thursday, casual Thurs, that's what we call it, and Friday, casual Shabbat. The Majority Report with Sam Cedar.
It is Friday, December 23rd, 2016. My name is Sam Cedar. This is the four-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live-ish to tape. Steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. Ladies and gentlemen, it's not just casual Friday. It's casual end of the year. So casual that we're actually a week away from the end of the year. But F it. As far as I'm concerned, this is the end of the year. In fact, as far as I'm concerned, this is the end of the decade. End of the century. Folks, we're rolling up the whole world today. On the program, to look back at the year that was. And probably, we'd just probably look back a couple of weeks. The great Cliff Schecter will be joining us. Also, for a final 2016 movie recommendation to either capture the essence of 2016 or to provide you succor for 2017. Matthew Film Guy and Isabel Gillies will be joining us. A double shot. All that and more on today's program, ladies and gentlemen. Just want to say that we've pre-taped this, because, you know, Matt had to fly to somewhere, I don't know, in the heartland of America where, the actual heartland of America where hopefully we'll have it fenced off. That's really the plan, right? We're going to just fence off, the Midwest and, to keep the contagion from spreading. And I've seen this in a movie, probably multiple movies, but we're going to have to do this. It's like The Man in the High Castle meets some other thing about a contagion. Maybe Contagion? Is that a movie? It doesn't matter. I think we all know the point. But folks, it being a casual Friday, even though this is rather untraditional for us because we're pre-recording it, not on a Friday, and it's the final, I guess, new show for a Friday in 2016. Despite all of that difference, we're going to ground it with something that I know that will make this more comfortable for you.
Cliff Schecter, Libertas LLC, New Media, Public Relations, and strategy. You want any of these services, you know who you gotta see. Cliff Schecter, Libertas LLC.com.
Yes, Cliff Schecter, happy new year, happy holidays, a Merry Christmas, happy Hanukkah, happy Kwanzaa. I hope you had a good winter solstice. And, what's up?
Are you missing anything? Are you being unpolitically correct? There must be another holiday out there.
I'm sure I'm dropping the ball somewhere. Happy Speech Code Day.
Also, if you don't say Merry Christmas at least twice, you're initiating a war on Christmas. Just know that.
If I don't say Merry Christmas?
At least a couple times in any given sentence. Clearly you're not showing the proper respect for Christmas and you hate all white Christians.
Well, all right. I mean, I've been guilty. Guilty. I don't want to lie.
Yeah, what's the time, Sam? We have new overlords in this country. Things have changed.
Yes, it's true, Cliff. We do have new overlords. We're not quite clear who they are. When we have some indication, right? I mean, General Flynn meeting with the head of the of the
Austrian Nazi Party. Austrian,
yeah, you know, I didn't realize.
I mean, they're not, they don't call themselves a Nazi Party, but they were formed by ex-Nazis in the 1950s to relive the good times. So they do have a bit of a history there.
Yeah, I mean, I think that I did not realize that they were literally, they were formed by literal Nazis.
Yes. They were formed by actual, I guess maybe they're members of the Austrian Nazi Party as opposed to the German one. But yes,
well, it's
they
not
were,
like
they
there's a history
out
of
in the
bad...
open Nazi supporters in Austria in the 1950s. Not sorry for what happened, but much more saying it should have been more.
Not like there's a history of bad Austrian Nazis.
No, none of the bad ones ever came from Austria, right?
Reminds me
of that Simpsons episode with where Kelsey Grammer was doing the voice. Was it Sideshow Bob? And he's in court, and he's defending something he says in German, and one of the jurors turns to the next one and says, any man who speaks German couldn't be bad. That kind of thing.
All right. Well, let's move on to our own. So Flynn met with them, and meanwhile, apparently, this was revealed by the head of that Austrian National Party when they had announced they had made some type of, I don't know, a friendship pact or blood oath with
Axis.
Yeah,
oath something of that nature
with the Russians. Meanwhile, we've got Russia and Turkey and Iran, I guess, meeting about the Syrian crisis.
And there's also, let's also be clear, there's Russian ambassadors being assassinated in Turkey, which tends to sort of bring certain memories of how World War I started back with all the international entanglements, and at the same time add to the immediate crisis going on over there. So that's not good. Our president of the United States still refuses to utter a negative word about Vladimir Putin, which to me is all the evidence I've ever needed. You know, you do have some people in some quarters on the left casting doubt upon the CIA, and certainly the CIA and other intelligence agencies have not always done the most above board job, not claiming they have. But to me, it's as obvious as the things that are just out in the open. You know what I mean? Like his lack of being able to say one negative word about them and even impugning the CIA to defend them.
It's weird. Trump's relationship with Russia is certainly weird. And there's certainly reason to be not the least bit suspicious of his business entanglements with Russian oligarchs. To a certain extent, let's as we look back on this year, and you know, we can project forward, but let's turn to, I guess, you know, Obama. Let's turn to like basically what's happened since the election with the Democratic Party, because I've been, and I know this is something that's been nagging at you a bit. Here's my question. Where is the Democratic Party? Like, you know, I don't want to kick a woman when she's down. But I mean, I feel like Hillary Clinton should be somewhat more present. And if she's not, then the president should be. I mean, I keep remembering. Do you remember this quote that Barney Frank told people when they were talking about giving money, TARP money, directly to homeowners? And apparently Hank Paulson had told Barney Frank, Bush has signed off on it, but we won't do it unless Obama signs off on it. And Barney Frank went to Obama about this, and Obama said, well, I'm sorry, I'm not going to. We only have one president at a time. This is during this period right now, the president-elect period. And Barney Frank said, well, actually, no, right now we have no presidents. And to a certain extent, I sort of feel like we're in that zone again.
Yeah. The situation is, it seems like with Obama, there's like this sort of need to always follow whatever the sort of rules are. It's almost like the opposite of the Republican Party. It's like the norms he sees there in front of him are ones where you literally can't criticize at all, can't be partisan at all. In no way can you can you sort of take a risk of sort of stepping forward and affecting the process, if you sort of understand what I'm saying? And I think it's always been one of his biggest problems by far. It's hurting us right now. When you say you don't want to kick a woman while she's down, well, I don't either. But I'm okay kicking a whole party while it's down. I mean, where the hell are all of them,
mm-hmm.
right? I mean, it isn't just Hillary, which I will say, where the hell is she? Where the hell is, I mean, Bernie Sanders has been out there, but most of the stuff he's been talking about has been his economic message, which is great. But right now, we need somebody speaking to we need a party speaking to what the hell is going on here. To the fact that we have a president of the United States coming in who lost by nearly 3 million votes, unprecedented, who's tweeting things at China that's getting them to grab American military hardware in the South China, in the South China Sea and threaten us, unprecedented, that we know for a fact that Russia in some way was involved in our election. And in trying to help the Republican Party. And again, I don't need just the CIA evidence. It is everywhere. It is obvious in the picks that Donald Trump has made, like Rex Tillerson and Flynn and others, that we've got people that we've got the worst among us. We've got people he's nominated that DeVos, who he nominated Betsy DeVos for the Secretary of Education post, has donated money to 17 of the senators who will be voting on whether she gets to become Secretary of Education. That we've got stories about Donald Trump already pressuring, the Kuwaiti royals to cancel a celebration in a hotel other than his and throw it in his hotel. That we've got the Trump brothers setting up a nonprofit and offering people for $1 million access to their dad. These I could actually keep going, like, for the next hour. Like, I mean, this is insane. And this is all the stuff we saw during the campaign. None of it has stopped in the slightest, from the crazy tweeting to the crazy conflicts of interest to the conspiracy theories being shared by Trump, the 3 million illegal voter claim, people like Drudge sending out crap about, well, if California and New York only didn't vote, and right-wingers are repeating all that, including members of the government, or congressmen. I don't know if I should consider them members of anything. All this stuff's going on, not to mention you've got Paul Ryan talking about this somehow this election being a mandate to get rid of Medicare. Where are all of them? I mean, we've got everything going on here, and they should be challenging. Remember when the Republicans are meeting deciding to challenge the legitimacy of a Democratic president who had been elected and had a 70% approval rating and won 365 electoral votes, had won by 7 points? Where are they?
That's actually a great point. Just the idea, on one hand, I'm thinking, okay, well, there are people coming out and talking about this and speaking up about this here or there in some type of scattershot way. But there's two things. One is that it's clear there's no concerted effort to deal with this.
Oh, absolutely not. No.
And on top of that, it's also clear, like, all I can think of is Chuck Schumer. All the stories about Chuck Schumer coming out are just him saying, well, we'll work with him on stuff that we like, and on stuff that we don't like, we're not going to work with him. It's almost as if they are, like, attempting to not make any news. Like, I get that Donald Trump is sucking up all the oxygen. But at the very least, like, if you were to have such a meeting and you were just basically all to stand around and say, like, let's just agree for the time being that this is what we're going to say. This is going to be our public face. We're not going to, at least you get some news. At least you would give a sense to people that we're not just, and I don't know that there's much they can do, but
you'd also be reminding people, I don't mean to cut you off, but the key part of all of that is you'd be weakening Donald Trump.
Yep.
If you keep reminding people constantly that he is illegitimate, that the Russians got involved in various ways to help him, that an FBI letter that was released, which we just found out again yesterday, there was nothing to that. that a Republican appointee released, which helped him at the very end. You know, the tweets he's sending out and the danger that's putting people in. I mean, those things, you can influence mainstream media, people writing about this and paying attention. You can even influence people that voted for Trump, and there were a decent number of them, because they thought, oh my God, I can't vote for Hillary Clinton, or oh my God, I can't vote for a Democrat, or whatever their reasoning was, but didn't think Trump was qualified to be president, because 60% plus of people said that, and he still got 46% of the vote. And the nearly 3 million votes. Again, like, the best thing to always do is the shoe is on the other foot. Think about that for a second. Think about the Republican Party. If Donald Trump, if things are reversed, Hillary Clinton loses by nearly 3 million votes, but wins by 40,000 votes, which is, I think, the final number, or 70,000, or somewhere in there, in three states. And ends up becoming the president. And, you know, a foreign power has quite clearly wanted her to win and did some things to help that. And the FBI director, you know, think about what they did, were willing to do to Valerie Plame, who is, you know, in intelligence. Think about what they've been willing to do to demonize all sorts of foreign countries when it's been useful to them. Think about what they've been willing to do when it comes to making sure they're able to get their person elected. Or not allow Democrats to make choices like, I don't know, you know, saying we won't put in, we'll steal a SCOTUS pick from you and we'll let you put in the Supreme Right. Court justice that you get to put in constitutionally. Or in North Carolina, the will of the people, which is what we said we wanted to wait for in the SCOTUS example federally, well, the will of the people elected a Democratic governor in North Carolina, so we're just going to go ahead and strip him of all sorts of powers before we have to leave office. The exact opposite theories. Just showing they don't care one bit about consistency. We know that, but I mean, this couldn't be any more blatant than the SCOTUS versus North Carolina example. They just want power. And while they're out there talking and tweeting and meeting with people and doing all sorts of unbelievable things, we can't even get our people who have the biggest microphones to point it out.
Yep.
I mean, you'll hear something here and there. I think Bernie Sanders said one or two things. I think Barack Obama maybe said one or two things. But there should be a concerted effort. It reminds me all over again of the Brooks Brothers riot and all that stuff in Florida.
Yeah.
Which is, you see one party brings in James Baker to run a virtual war room. The other party's like, well, you know, put Joe Lieberman on to apologize and say we'll count all veteran votes, even if they were sent after the period of time when people are legally allowed to vote. Because, you know, we don't want to get anybody upset. And it's like, you know, at some point, I think that that's about the only thing that's more dispiriting than losing, is when the people on your side literally seem like they have no fight in them and don't care. Well, you know, okay, a lunatic who tweets stuff at China and does everything else I just listed, not to mention sexual assault, which I didn't, and on and on and on, is now the president of the United States, is going to be. Let's not say anything
It has a. It also has the. Not only is it dispiriting, but it also begins to undercut the credibility of a lot of these people, right? Who, I mean, all of them across the board, who said Donald Trump is a fundamental threat to our democracy. Well, I mean, wasn't the hypothetical that if he wins, he's a fundamental threat? Well, he's won. So, like, what are you doing? I'd like to think that they're all meeting in some type of secret town. You know, like, we're meeting at the special townhouse. We go every day at 11 a.m. and we spend 6 hours and we're plotting out all this stuff. We're going to lay low now. But I don't get the sense, and maybe I'm wrong.
I'd love
but
to believe
I,
that.
I do not get the sense. This is a strategy. I don't believe there is a strategy. And I don't know that I would make it as much about the things that you were talking about, but it almost doesn't matter what it is, as long as there's something. I mean, I would take that guy, Huizinga from Michigan, who was
like
on
to speak to Birchers.
Yeah. That's Mulvaney who was speaking to Birchers.
Right.
I would go after the cabinet picks. I would go after because there's plenty of fodder there for any path you want to take.
Oh, my God. I
would go after Huizinga just as an example to say, like, this is what they're going to do to your Medicare. This is what they're going to do to the Affordable Care Act, so that when you get to hearings, you have a predicate. Do you agree with this congressman that you should be doing X, Y, or Z? I mean, there's just so much. There's so much.
You know, I mean, that's what I'm saying, Sam. It actually doesn't almost matter. Again, it sort of reminds me of the Democrats during the election, you know, which is you pick two or three, you know, you pick an overall narrative, like a slogan, and it's pretty easy because generally it should be based on the truth. And you fit under that, you sort of three sub areas that all tie into it. With Trump, it's pretty easy. You know, it would be corruption. It would be potentially treason with Russia. And I would say it would also be incompetence. And then you can fold everybody into that narrative because you've got all sorts of cabinet picks, some of whom are reading conspiracy sites, most of whom have no experience in what it is he's bringing them up to do, many of whom are corrupt to the core, have done things like made gazillions of dollars over kicking people out of their homes. And, I mean, you know, so everyone would fit under those meta-narratives. That's what you would do if you had a – but this just reminds me of what we dealt with at the worst moments of the Obama administration, not explaining what the hell Obamacare was to people, which they admitted later on. Yeah, we screwed that up. You know, but they never learn. It just happens again and again. And I'm saying – I don't know. I mean, I don't want to dispirit activists further, but, you know, I don't know how people do it. Because quite frankly, you know, this is the kind of stuff that makes you just sort of want to throw up your hands and walk away. It's like these people, as you said, make these claims during election about how dangerous this guy is. And there's all sorts of ways to slow him down and stop him. I mean, the whole Electoral College vote, which most people wouldn't peep and say a word about, some people might decide that that's a bad precedent for democracy to do that. And fine, if that's the conclusion you come to, that's fine. That Republic. But my whole thing would be, like everything else, when you find yourself saying this is a bad precedent, remember, Republicans will do it, whatever it is. They don't need to wait for us. They didn't need to wait for us to do what they just did in North Carolina. They didn't need to wait for us to do what they just did with the Scalia replacement pick. Those are both things that are unprecedented, right. And they felt just fine doing them. They'll do this at some point. So I don't buy into that anymore because we're not two equal sides where if we do something bad, we give them a precedent so they can do it. They're going to do it. So on the electors, would you have stopped him? Would you have gotten 38 electors? Almost definitively not. I'd say 0.1. But what you would do is remind people he's illegitimate by running a real campaign, by having President Obama come out and say stuff, by having Hillary Clinton come out, by having activist groups, although the activist groups did do a decent amount around that. But if they were supported by the infrastructure of the party and by the biggest voices, I feel like I saw two congressional members say something. Like Jim Himes said something, and I think, Senator from Oregon, whose name is not coming to me. Progressive said something, and that was it. And it just so this reminds me of the worst aspects in every way of the Democratic Party, where you're just like, it's not even about whether they're progressive or they're moderate or they're whatever. It's not even about ideology. It's about having a spine and being willing to stand up for anything. I mean, if at this moment this guy who you've said is so dangerous got into office the way he got into and has the threat he has for our future and is already pitching people for cabinet posts with the backgrounds, with the serious conflicts of interest and the corruption and the ties to Russia and, you know, everything else wrong with them, how the hell can you be sitting there not saying things right now because, oh, we want a smooth transition? Well, no. I believe very much in institutions, and I would want a smooth transition if it were Romney or McCain or somebody that fell within the bounds of sort of normality. But that's not what we're dealing with here. And they're normalizing this guy and everything about how he won.
Yeah, aside the normalization, they're just not effectively, like, if you're going to fight this guy, you have to fight this guy. And I think, you know, one of the things that that would come up a lot back in the Bush era was the concept of the value of waging a fight, even those that you knew you were going to lose. And that to me seems... That seems even more relevant today than then. I mean, you know, the Democrats are going to have to fight losing battles that they know are losing battles, and they're going to have to do it. Well, I mean, They got to do it a month and a half ago is when they have to start with this.
But it just, you know, it reminds me of sort of so much else, and that's what's so incredibly frustrating about it, whether it's the fact that ALEC has been around since 1973, and we still, it looks like this new organization that's been around a year or two, six, is finally going to get funding, but, you know, it took till 2016,
right.
And who knows if they're going to be able to accomplish anything or get close to digging in at the level ALEC already has, because, you know, I'm in Ohio, and I've sat here, the Midwest people that you're scared to build a wall to keep me from coming back over there, or I may infect you all.
Right.
I think you started the show that way, which I found amusing. I actually did. I'm not saying that in a negative way. Well, you know,
I can't catch it over the phone, can I?
I don't think so, but I was already in your – I came back and did one live studio, so you're probably all infected.
Well, you got to spray this place down.
It's an airborne virus.
I did spray it down. You don't even know about it.
Okay, well, I hope so. After, too, before and after. But I digress.
While you were there.
I mean, you know, they made John Kasich here look moderate because he only signed a 20-week abortion ban.
Right.
And he vetoed the 6-week double secret probation insane one. Right. I mean, he just signed the guns everywhere bill here. He just signed the bill banning localities from passing a $15 minimum wage. Like, they are on a bender here right now. And if we had anything like what the right has, where they're talking to legislators in the state level, people in the state level, they've got talk radio in basically
right.
every corner of every state. And we don't have, there's nothing like that to counter that in Cincinnati. And so it sort of just reminds, or I don't think in the rest of Ohio, maybe something in Cleveland, but it just reminds me of everything else where we've been asleep at the wheel, you know, after the Supreme Court, decision Citizens United passed, and Democrats are all sitting around like, I wonder what we'll do about that. Well, they were organizing and taking over state legislatures and gerrymandering us out of existence in most swing states and in Congress. I mean, that's what I mean. It's like, it seems like part of being on the left is to sort of just be like, okay, we'll get them next time. And while the people on the right are like fighting like this is their last breath for every inch of power. And it's incredibly dispiriting. And that's the way it feels right now to me watching this, with nobody saying anything as Trump's moving forward, nobody coming out and questioning his legitimacy except for a few people. You know,
there's just no fight. I mean, there's just no fight. And the interesting thing that strikes me, too, is that, you know, this is a problem. And I will say that, like, I think it's less a problem on the, and I don't want to get too caught up in semantics here, but less a problem on the left and more a, you know, like the genuine left and more a problem on the sort of center left, and which, you know, sadly encompasses a lot more people in my estimation. Not necessarily, and by center left, well, maybe that's not the right word. I'm talking about there's a lot of people who don't engage in politics, who, you know, Trump's election has sort of, at the very least, briefly woken them up a little bit. And they're looking around going like, wait, isn't something supposed to happen now? Isn't there supposed to be, like, isn't there, you know, an apparatus here for something? Like, isn't President Obama supposed to do something? Isn't somebody supposed to do something? And, you know, when I come across these people, I definitely want to say, like, yeah, somebody's supposed to do something. You're supposed to get in your time machine and start paying attention to politics 3 years ago. And, you know, that's what needed to happen so that you could understand the stakes of this and stop thinking that somebody else is going to come and fix it. And
yeah, you know, and my question, you know, for you, have you had David Wallman on the show recently?
Cagro X?
Yeah.
No, I have not.
So, you know, did you see the theory that he had out, and he seems to know his procedural stuff in the Senate quite well?
Yes, yeah, we talked about that on the show, how the Democrats could actually seat Merrick Garland on essentially the day of the swearing-in ceremony,
right,
where Biden, let me just tell people, that Biden gets the gavel, and instead of basically handing it over to Mitch McConnell for the swearing-in procedures, he says, I'm calling on Dick Durbin. And Dick Durbin says,
and because there'll be a quorum there.
Yes, there'll be a quorum. Right. And people should understand, because more Republicans were up for re-election than Democrats, you would have a 34 a Democratic.
30, I think 34, 30 and one independent or something like that.
Yeah.
There'd be more Democrats than Republicans is the key thing here.
Yes. And Durbin could say at that point, we nominate Merrick Garland. Let's have a vote. 34.
And they could do that with every other outstanding federal judge right now who they refuse to vote on. Now, to me, when you've just watched them steal a Supreme Court pick from you, and this is the only way you can get it back, and you've just watched what they did in North Carolina, which this would be no different than,
Yeah.
And you could make both of those arguments, that that SCOTUS pick was ours and they refused to do anything for a year. And what they just did in North Carolina, this is no different than that. These could be your arguments to the mainstream media. And yeah, they'd still write some breathless stories about upping the ante and whatever. But again, much like with the elector thing, you know that if the situation is reversed, which it may someday be, they will take this opportunity and do exactly that as they just did in North Carolina. So there's no reason not to do it.
And I would add,
you know that Obama and Biden, maybe Biden would left his own devices because he fights a little more, but you just know they're not going to do it. And that's what's so frustrating is that you feel like, I feel like if you're, you know, I don't know the metaphor here to take a bad one from something I often talk about. Well, let's say you're in a shooting contest. It seems like, you know, our target is we have to get it through a keyhole while they have an entire building to hit.
Right.
That kind of feels like the difference. We need a straight flush. They can get like, you know, two of the same card. I mean, you always feel like you're at a massive disadvantage fighting them because the other side is willing to do what it takes to win and our side just isn't. And that's what I mean. I mean, this should be a no-brainer right now. Obama's leaving office. They spent 8 years, you know, blocking everything of his possible. They're going to try to undo all of his stuff. They called him every name in the book and even implied said he wasn't American for years. This should be easy to do and sail on off into the sunset. And at least we'd know that the federal courts and the Supreme Court were heavily weighted towards us, so maybe that would offer some manner of protection. So there's a practical reason to do it too, with this guy coming into power.
Absolutely, you need some toehold somewhere. And yes, I mean, you know, what would the press say? I mean, like the idea that there is no limit to what the Republicans can do, and to a certain extent, society's supposed to eat it, right? Versus the idea of
like, them being bad again. That's the Republicans, right?
And
they do that kind of stuff.
And
right.
and the reason why this frame exists is a function, it seems to me, of the Democratic Party's own
weakness.
Cowardice and weakness. They will not push the envelope. And if you don't push the envelope, the expectations for what you can get away with, obviously, they shrink. I mean, people don't. I think people don't judge. You know, people don't judge the parties against each other. They judge the parties against themselves. And so, you know, the baseline.
I mean, all of life is about that, right?
I think that's true.
You create a culture in any institution or around yourself. You can call it your personality, but you create a culture, if you want to call that, expectations. And when you act outside those expectations, people notice, and either in a good or a bad way, and they will remark upon it. The Republicans have created such expectations that it's almost like, oh, okay. Well, what they did in North Carolina, they didn't actually have a coup, and McCrory didn't actually refuse to leave office. So in a way, they're behaving. They only took
right.
away a bunch of Cooper's powers. But, you know, and you're right. That's why the press was almost shocked, because the only good thing I can find where the Democrats seem to have the cojones to do anything was when Harry Reid finally, was it 13 or 14, where he just said, sorry, we're getting rid of the filibuster for the
yep.
lower judges because you won't put any of them on the court. It was a response. It wasn't the first. We weren't the aggressor there. We were responding to a crisis they caused by attacking norms. And that's my point here, is we don't have to be the first one to cross certain norms. But when they attack them, when they attack the norm of not allowing Democrats to put a Supreme Court justice on who belongs there, who should be our pick, then you have to cross norms, too, to make it clear that that behavior is unacceptable. Because anything less than doing that is saying it is. It's conceding defeat and saying, guess what? We're emboldening you. You should get worse. Because otherwise, how do you read the last 20 years? Of, you know, the rise of Newt Gingrich and Iran-Contra, when this sort of behavior started to become acceptable on the right, well, by conceding every time and trying to play nice every time, you know, the Brooks Brothers riot and everything else, I mean, what has that gotten us? Nothing.
Nothing. And the institutions are not any more protected, frankly. I mean, they can't function anymore with only one participant, you know, one major participant out of the two respecting them than they could if both were disrespecting them. In other words, like, you know, like the Democrats aren't salvaging anything. And certainly the filibuster thing, proved hugely important, right? I mean, just at least you have the D.C. Circuit. Now, of course, they can expand, and they probably will. They'll probably expand the size of that court and then just pack it. And that might even be a dry run for what they could do for the Supreme Court.
I wouldn't be shocked at all to see them do that with the Supreme Court. All the more reason why getting someone like Merrick Garland on there right now is so important.
I mean, with the Supreme Court, they, you know, they could do it and they could claim this is a response to it. I mean, who knows? But the bottom line is you have to put it out there. People had a very...
But again, you, as we just said, Sam, I don't mean to interrupt, but again, if they're going to do it, they would do it anyhow. Sure, if you push Merrick Garland on there this way, they could say, well, this is a response to that.
Right.
And then you'd say, well, what we did is a response to the fact that this there was a year that went by and you would not let us put somebody on the court. And you said the will of the people will get to decide. Well, you know, 3 million more people voted for Hillary Clinton. So maybe it doesn't now, with our arcane system, maybe it doesn't allow her to get to be president. But certainly the people did speak.
Right.
You know, I mean, there's a lot of ways to defend it if you've got a messaging operation that's beyond sort of, you know, fourth grade level. And you have any media apparatus, which we mostly don't, because our side has not seen fit. All the billionaires and people with all the money on our side haven't seen fit to do anything to respond to a 24/7 propaganda machine in Fox News. You know, I mean, because that's how you know if this were different. If this whole election cycle, you put the shoe on the other foot, that's how you know how things would turn out, because you think to yourself, what would Fox News be saying?
All right, let me...
Right? What would Fox News have said about Russia helping Hillary win? What would Fox News have said about Hillary, you know, losing by 3 million votes but winning by 40,000 or whatever in those couple states? What would they have said about the Comey incident? What would they have said if Hillary Clinton had 5 different children with 3 different husbands?
Right.
These are the things you can imagine, and it just... We allow this huge opening for Republicans. They can get away with so much more, and they do so much more. And we do nothing to
what
try
do you
to test
think
that.
It is about, you know, and we just got a couple of minutes left here. And so, you know,
sorry, I've turned the whole show into a great big show.
No,
party,
I mean, but I think, look, that's the mood that people are in. I mean, this is sadly the way that we're going to enter 2017 is with this sort of, you know, and I think the key is we're still in 2016. So, you know, there's no better time than now to expunge ourselves of this stuff. But what do you think it is? I mean, I seem to remember myself saying in 2004, like what happened with Bill Clinton, the election of Bill Clinton, was that liberals went asleep. And there is a quality about the way liberals perceive government and more than just government, society in some ways.
Yes.
And culture that. And it's reflected in donors. One of the big things that I hear from people who work at there's not many really liberal think tanks, but there's a couple, but also like liberal magazines and liberal agencies and foundations that are trying to get funding, that liberal donors, big liberal donors, are much more inclined to donate money for projects, for specific projects with a specific objective, finite. Here's $50,000 or here's $500,000 to create this program, period.
Yep.
As opposed to on the right, where they will fund operations. They'll just say, like, here is X amount of money.
Or they'll just sow chaos. They'll find the Joker in like someone like O'Keefe who just wants to burn everything down and say here's millions.
Here's the difference though that with a liberal donor, they would go to O'Keefe and they would say rather than like here's $1 million to run your operation, here's $1 million or $500,000 whatnot. I want you to do a special series on, on this. And so none of the money can go to operations, which puts a further burden on the organization, right? Because now you're like, you're having to bend to where the money wants you to go. And it's not necessarily, it's slightly off your agenda, whatnot. And I think
well, and you also can't
building,
do what you, but, what maybe is best to be done on that issue or on in that area, because you have to do specifically what somebody wants, as
exactly
opposed to what the data tells you to
do. And I'm also drawing an analogy to the way that liberals, and by liberals I mean just like, you know, center to the left, perceive electoral politics. It's like it's a project. 16 months out from the election, we're going to start the project, and then we're going to end it the day after the election, and that's the end of it. And whereas the Republicans have a four-year, there's no cycle here. It just happens like, it's just like, it's another chapter of the same book, as opposed to like restarting the book every time with liberals. And I'm just struggling with like why that's the case. I have a theory about the project-based thing, which is just that liberals tend to be a little bit more creative. Even the ones that aren't want to be, because they see more value in that. And so they want to feel like they have built something specifically. They want to feel like they've created something that is different from just the sort of ongoing maintenance of fighting for... And maybe it's also, you know, you want change. So you want like specific issues to be dealt with. I mean, we have this problem where everybody's an issue.
Part of it. My theory, which I don't think necessarily competes, it could sort of, in a way, cooperate with that, is I think liberals also are good government types who often are not comfortable with what the real political world is. And the fact that sometimes you got to get your hands dirty. And because I can't tell you how many times I've run into this on the left and various clients I've worked for, various funding for things like, well, we can't do that. And I'm not talking about, because my rule has always been I would never do anything illegal. So let's start by saying that if people think I'm talking about something terrible and nefarious. No, I'm just talking about, you know, saying, look, sometimes you got to get tough to win. Sometimes you got to go after people and expose certain information. There's certain things you have to do. Sometimes when Joe Biden is gaveling in for a second, you have to vote in your Supreme Court justice.
Right.
Because sometimes to win, that's what you have to do. But we sort of have the mentality of an above it all Barack Obama, who in the end, I think, will be remembered as a very good president who passed a lot of good legislation, even if he didn't do certain things we would have liked him to do.
That got totally reversed.
But right. Well, a lot of it will be. But it was always above the partisan stuff, above the party building, because that was sort of the gritty, you know, that's what the sort of hacks do. You know, it was too sort of intellectual and above it all, because that seemed like the dirty stuff that, you know, was above, remember, letting the independent money run on its own. He had to corral it all because he didn't trust it back then, or he didn't want it to be spent, as I remember, in 08 originally. He thought that was a bad thing to happen while the right was doing that. I mean, that's really, that those instincts seem to be everywhere on the left. And, you know, that's great for certain segments of our society, but that's not the way politics work. And maybe some aspects of policy do work that way, and that's great, you know, when they do. But if you're not always ready for the fact that sometimes the other side, and not sometimes, constantly, the other side will cheat. They will suppress votes. They will find, you know, the loopholes to win. They'll recall people, you know, if they can. I mean, the way they broke that precedent with Gray Davis back in 2002, you know, they'll put on a Brooks Brothers riot if they need that to win power. There's things they will do. And while we don't want to be doing anything that's illegal and should never do anything illegal, within what the realm of what's legal, we should be willing to do lots of things that we don't currently do. And play hardball in a way that we don't currently do it. And that, you know, again, this is my theory on why it is, from sometimes being in rooms here and there and sort of being shocked at what, you know, at sort of the unilateral disarmament that takes place on our side. But whatever it is, you know, this is the situation. And it puts us at a massive disadvantage.
Massive.
I mean, really mad. I mean, again, someone like O'Keefe or these people on the, they can't exist without, you know, Koch brothers, Adelson, whoever it is who funds him, I'm sure some of those types, and Mercers. That can't exist without that. And I'm talking about the lawful things he's done that are just terrible, not the illegal things he's done, again, to stress that. But they can't exist without that. It can't exist without a 24/7 propaganda outlet like Fox that will play it all day, night, and long, and push it into so it shows up in, you know, the Politico morning newsletter and all that kind of stuff. We have nothing like that. You know, there's been thought behind what they've put together, and as you said, ours is very specifically programmatic. And again, it's not to say there's Media Matters, there's the Center for American Progress, there's some good infrastructure that's been built on the left, but my God, does it not compare? And it shows at times like this. It really does. And the different mentalities show, because we're sitting here and we're allowing this guy, I mean, to have somebody as far out of the mainstream as him on the left, you'd probably have to have like Hugo Chavez.
Right.
And, you know, we're barely a peep from our guys right now. It's crazy. And I didn't want to end the year on
this. Well, I was going to say, resolution for 2017?
No, there's no resolution except for don't give up.
Right.
You know, because I spent this show saying how dispiriting it is. But as dispiriting as it is, if people aren't willing to do this, then think about how much worse things could be. Because even with all of that, we still got almost 3 million more popular votes. We still had many more votes for our senators. We still have a super state in California that is basically about 98% Democratic at this point, and frankly could be a great counterbalance to what's going on in Washington considering the population. I'd almost love that there'd be like agreement between legislatures on all the West Coast states and almost as a super state to show what this country can do.
Right.
My guess is the feds will try to strike some of it down, but that's it would be great if they could push the envelope over there as far as possible to show how much our ideas work.
Yeah, you know, we spoke to Tom Gagin last week, I think it was, who had, you know, some ideas about what could happen in the states. I mean, I think I just want to reiterate that point, too. I mean, look, it's a bad situation. But with that said, and I don't think that there's any scenario where we're going to be a net positive whenever we get to the other side of this era. And I don't know that it's guaranteed that we're going to that it's not going to be a severe net negative, but I do think that there is, I do think there's opportunities. I don't think there's opportunities to necessarily be in a better position that we would have in an alternate universe, but I do think there's opportunities to mitigate this. And, you know, the other thing is that we're not, it's not like the Republicans are super genius. They're just brutes. Essentially.
Yes.
And
they have the
brute, you know, a brute going through a China shop can destroy it. But when the brute owns the China shop,
a little jujitsu on a brute and use their own power against them.
That's right. And the bottom line is like now they own the China shop. It's their China shop. They're still the brute. They're still the bull. You know, they still got to walk through that China shop. It's just that now it's their stuff to break. And so,
well, and that's why I just want to, that's why I'm just trying to say what I'm trying to say, which is this can all be dispiriting. And, but in a way, these are the times that really can prove your character. You know, when you're down, I hate to sound like, oh, you know, like a Rocky Balboa speech at the end, but you know, when life throws you these kinds of challenges, this is when you prove what you're made of. And this is when you say, yeah, they have all the advantages. They've, you know, which we've been talking about this show. And yet they still lost by nearly 3 million votes. They still need to gerrymander to win the House and suppress votes and do whatever, because we're in the majority and we know we're in the majority. And so you just need to remember that and not give up and bring whatever gifts you have to the process and you know, fight for the country you want. That's what I would say. That should be that's my 2017 resolution. Is with everything I've said this show, it doesn't make me one bit. You know, I can have an hour or two where I get dispirited and say I don't want to do this anymore. But you know what? All I have to do is look at one or two things these guys have done, and I'm right back in it.
And
so, there are going to be plenty of those things to get you excited about and want you to get back in it. I promise you.
All right. Well, Cliffy, we're looking forward to talking to you in 2017. Thanks so much, buddy. Thank you so much for showing up here week in, week out, helping us understand what has gone on in the week prior and the weeks prior each week. I really, really appreciate it. I know our audience loves it, but I really do appreciate it as well. Have a great holiday.
Well, thank you.
Have a great new year. And we'll
you
talk
too,
in 2017.
And to the whole audience and Michael and everybody in the studio there. And who's in the studio, by the way, right now?
Who's in the studio right now is Matt and Michael. Kelly has had to step out.
Enjoy it, Cliff.
Okay. Well, I wanted to wish to everyone. So Matt, Michael, and
Kelly will be listening.
Everybody
in
there.
This place.
I'm sorry?
Kelly will be listening, so you can say.
Well, and Kelly, too. You guys are awesome. It's been a great year, and it's fun coming on. And, you know, if I didn't do this, I'd have to go somewhere. I'd be punching bag.
Tell me about it.
So thank you for listening to me, everyone. No, seriously, thanks for having me on, and everyone have a great new year.
All right, we'll talk to you soon, Cliff. All right, folks, we're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, bing, boom, bing, boom, we're going to be getting some movie recommendations from Matthew Film Guy. And Isabel Gillies. We're going to take a quick break with some music, and then when we come back, we'll be talking to both of them. We'll be right back after this.
Forgive the kids, for they don't know how to live. Run the alleys casually.
Oh my God, ladies and gentlemen, this happens only once a year. There is precedent for this. You recall that time in Ghostbusters where they combined the streams. And you've seen in many films and stories where when maybe it's TV shows where it's they talk about matter meeting antimatter. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that is happening. Can we play? Is it possible we could play both theme songs simultaneously? I don't think we want to do that. Let's start with, well, I don't know which one he's planning to start with, but we're going to have two theme songs in a row because we have two guests. And here's the first theme song.
Today is Casual Friday. Let us welcome Isabel Gillies to the show. She's going to recommend a movie or two to watch on Netflix. It's the only way I know. Listen to the picks from Isabel. IsabelGillies.com.
That's right. IsabelGillies.com. There she is, folks. And Isabel, let us play the theme song to our other guest that we have in our once in a year, our annual, not clash, but meeting of the Titans.
Rock it out.
Matthew, the film guy, is choosing your streams. Cassavetes on Netflix and other such themes. Maybe you'll watch one and learn a few things. Please recommend me a movie to stream. Matthew, please recommend me a movie to stream. Matthew, film guy.
Did I hear some whistle accompaniment?
Yeah, you know, I whistled to Isabel's, and then I felt bad that I wasn't whistling to yours, but it's not as whistly of a tune.
Not really. No. But good try. That was definitely a valiant effort. I appreciate it.
Well, anytime
you could
I
do
can...
like a...
I mean, I feel like I did a little bit of... I don't know. So, Isabel, Matthew, how are you guys? Isabel, you answer first.
May I just say that I feel like it is once a year, but I feel like the last time we did it was 2 weeks ago. That's how fast life is flying by.
Yeah. Wow. All right. Fair enough. I feel like the past month and a half has been like years since the election. I feel like it's been the, yesterday or was the shortest day of the year, the winter equinox or
solstice. Is today.
Solstice. Well, it's today. We're recording it today.
Oh, no. You're right.
I'm pretending. But nevertheless.
Time travel.
The days.
End of the democracy is slow for you.
I want the days to be even shorter. I want them to last like 5 minutes so that we can sort of get through the next 4 years very quickly. Yeah. Wake up, maybe brush your teeth, go back to bed.
Oh, that's the theory behind speeding up Trump's tapes.
That's exactly right.
I get it. All right, I see how it all connects.
I want it all to end quicker. And Matthew, how are you doing? Do you feel like time is flying for you?
Time goes wiping out very fast in my experience.
Okay. All right, fair enough. That's a really...
It's like a Cat Stevens song.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's really...
Time goes wiping out.
That's prosaic, I guess, more prosaic than poetic sense of that, I guess.
Pick your P word, Sam. Pick your P word.
Well, okay, poo-poo. Now, guys, how are you both doing with the election? I mean, Matthew, is this... it's been a while for you to digest. How are you doing?
Sam, I'm about as well as I was last time, which is to say not that great.
Right.
I'm in the stage of acceptance, but I'm also in the stage, I think now finally, of retrenchment. I'm going to read even more. I'm going to listen to even more political podcasts, which, by the way, there are some great political podcasts out there, Sam, if
Let's
you want
not,
me to recommend you.
No.
No? Okay. But I just feel like, I don't know, I go through a periods of, overload with the details, and then just like I want more details. I want to know exactly the appointments. I want to know exactly who they're related to and who they're connected to and whose interests they're representing. But, thankfully my job allows me the ability to, like I said last time we were on, go a little bit more macro and ask myself, what is this whole thing called life about? Why do people do these things that I find so personally so troubling or so alien to me? And it's an opportunity to expand my own mind to hopefully include the totality of human experience and not feel like, this election means that there's something wrong with the world totally.
Wow.
Isabel, are you okay? I feel like...
That
we all need
good.
To take like this Xanax or Halidol.
Pretty What's deep.
How are you doing, Isabel?
That was good, Matthew Film Guy. I too am in about the same place as I was last time, whereby, except that I keep thinking, I really was one of those people that was like, the electors are going to do it. It's like, even though that would have caused an array of problems that sort of, democracy is kind of short wiring if that happens, right? So that would be hard. But I keep thinking that something's going to happen and it won't be the way it is. And I actually think that the world is kind of not, I just put my head in the pillow. I'm having a hard time still.
Isabel needs a deus ex machina here. We're all just waiting for that deus ex machina.
Yes, well, exactly. And then, a friend of mine, everything's totally okay, but she took her kid to Berlin. And I talked to her on the phone. She was like, we're going to Berlin. And I was like, that's fun. And then in the back of my mind, I was like, what if something bad happens? And then it did. I just feel like there's nothing bad happened to them, but obviously, there's terror situation in Berlin. But I just feel like the world is a dangerous place, and I'm justified in thinking of that, and that no one is in charge. that's going to make it less dangerous. They're just going to make it more dangerous. And also, what's killing me are all the magazine covers with the Obamas on it saying goodbye. It's like a little heartbreak every time I walk down Broadway.
Let me ask you this, Isabel, because I sort of feel like that you're, I don't want to say you're an Obama bot. In any way.
But, oh, I am.
Okay, so you're an Obama. What did you think about his press conference? What was your reaction to that press conference the other day? Did you watch it? Did you have any feedback on it?
I didn't watch it.
No. Okay, so because he was supposedly going to come in and talk about the Russian thing. No, I was just curious because, I think you know, you're not as politically engaged, I think, as we are around here. I mean, Matthew,
that's
it sounds
true.
Like he's upset, getting a little obsessive, which is, you know, good for business, at least on this end. But so I'm curious how people reacted to that. But let me ask you both a different question then. This sense of danger, of doom. I mean, obviously, we come from one perspective, which is normal people as opposed to people who voted for Trump. So I will acknowledge that bias right up front. But how do you think this is going to play out in our culture? I mean, my neighbor has a theory that, because he's from the tech world, he thinks like that era of people showing up, like, I'm going to do something really disruptive that's going to be great for the world. We're going to develop the best custom-made clothing app for the world that has ever seen. We're going to get to efficiencies. Like, he thinks that that whole attitude is going to change now because there's just a darkness to a Trump regime. What do you think? Do you think we're going to see that in art, culture?
Well, what about the great protest songs? What about, you know, We Shall Overcome maybe we'll get some great songs of freedom out of it.
Well, we got what was that green what was the name of that band? Green American
Green Day.
They did a lot of stuff like the Decemberists. That's all that comes to mind last time around. I don't know.
Oh,
I mean,
yeah,
what do you think?
True.
What do you think, Matthew?
You caught me at a particularly dark moment because I feel like we finally do I actually start to accept that we are presiding over the end of this stage of civilization and that business values and capitalism is going to basically just choke everything, every other value out of the marketplace, so to speak, or just the realm of human existence. So I don't have any expectation that with the way that the internet is set up today, the way that media is set up today, the way that we get our information, apart from valiant efforts such as yours and Two Dope Boys and things like that, but I don't see that there's going to be a space for that kind of thing because there's just so much noise. The signal to noise ratio that you like to talk about, Sam, I think it's just so overwhelming right now between anything that is genuine, is hand woven or is heartfelt or genuine compared to the thing that gets out there because it's got a multi-million-dollar marketing platform behind it. I don't see that those spaces are opening up. I mean,
I'm not proposing that their spaces open. I'm just asking you a more general question. Like, you know, look, they're still going to make those multi-million dollar movies, obviously, tens of millions of dollars, and they'll be making all sorts of types of movies or music or whatnot.
I'm not even just talking about movies. You know, just anything, whether it's something a book you write or a song you write or a poem you write, anything that's not primarily commercially viable. I just don't see the path.
Let me ask you this then. Do you think the commercially viable stuff is going to change in its nature? Like, do you think that the darkness that we're feeling is going to be reflected in the broader culture now? And you know, some could say, well, I mean, you're just feeling that you're in a bubble, a New York bubble. Well, yeah, I would
literally
add, like,
we are in a New York bubble.
We're in a New York bubble.
But what about authenticity? Because I think that authenticity is being challenged all over the place, and, you know, fake news and fake, you know, what's the truth and all that. And so maybe there's going to be a growth of you know, folk art and carving and sculpture and things that are really real that you can feel tangible. Maybe there'll be a movement, you know, to making your own clothes and, you know, just that kind of thing. Like some things that people can feel that are tangible, because it's all gotten so intangible and elusive.
I mean, that's
no,
it.
I don't think so.
I think there's something to that, actually. I mean, I definitely think there's a sense of, like, there's no institutions. There's no watersheds anymore, right? Like, you can't, there's nobody, there's no acknowledgement, broad acknowledgement of any specific reality or any particular authority, right? I mean, there's none. And, you know, maybe something that is just so, naked in some way, like a carved piece of wood. I mean, I'm not suggesting, but that's possible.
I think there'll be a resurgence of counterculture like that, I think, even more broadly than that. But can I ask Matthew just a really quick question? But what about the prank phone call market, Matthew? Because arguably the Jerky Boys wouldn't have done their work without the Reagan era. So
maybe that is where we need to start focusing our efforts on, just finding better and newer ways to prank people. Maybe so. Yes. Look,
Good Lord, I hate pranks.
Why?
Well, now we've just found our first victim.
Why?
Just because, you know, I don't have a very great sense of humor, so
I don't think it's funny.
I think it's upsetting, and I don't like it when people do it. And I'm just sensitive.
There's never been a prank that's made you laugh.
Well, sometimes that show.
Prince John in the Can.
America's Funniest Videos makes me laugh, but that's not really pranks.
Aren't those a lot meaner than pranks? Because some of those videos,
no.
Aren't those like people actually getting hurt? I'm confused.
No, okay. Like when the ones like the, you know, the people, well, sometimes.
Wait a second. You just, I don't like prank calls. I like to see people fall off of their roofs in a funny way.
Or like when the people are getting married and the whole, you know, hoopush collapses or something.
That's horrible. Yeah. See, that's incredible. I don't think that's funny.
Your dog's on my lawn.
Isabel is just co-predicting like that movie Idiocracy did, you know, where the number one show on TV becomes Ow My Balls. Just reduce.
I hate Idiocracy, Matthew.
It's going to Potty Town. I think that fart jokes are funny, so it might be that.
Saul does too. I gotta say,
I don't think fart jokes are funny at all. It's amazing. Okay, I'm not tracking it. Okay.
George Carlin made some funny fart jokes. There's a way for
it's a high bar.
But you know, honestly, that you make an interesting point there, just referencing those kinds of base humors is. You know, Sam, the thing about the hand worn and the carving, the other problem is that our pipeline for getting things, which originally I was very excited about, and maybe on a better day I would be still totally excited about, which is the internet, which, you know, I'm carrying something in my pocket that I can use to watch movies pretty much from anywhere at all times. But I feel like it also is, again, it's that signal to noise ratio where, yes, I have in my hand access to things that wouldn't necessarily come to me otherwise, where in the past I'd have to travel to cities like New York or L.A. or Paris or London to see. But it'll never reach me because of this just giant roar of bullshit that's trying to be sold to me at all times. You know, if you've got the access but there's a crowd trying to get in the gate, you'll never see the show. So I feel like those little things that need to be cultivated and need to be sort of nurtured to find an audience just will die on the vine.
Well, and also
people making things, they just, you know, where do they get seen?
But ready for this? Here's one more. Here's a bump, more, a more devastating point.
Bum
to
me out.
Jump
bum
off
me out
of that.
Bad.
Ready? Not only is the noise, you won't be able to sort it out because of the noise and all of the static that's happening almost like physically, if you think of the internet as a physical thing, but I saw a movie the other day that was beautiful, and in the movie theater, so I won't say what it was, but
you can say what it was.
It was that, Manchester by the Sea movie.
I saw
my
that.
Ability to really? Suspend disbelief and to give in to my imagination and to my emotional world. And actually, you know, I did do it recently once at a LaGuardia High School production of Les Mis. I was able for the first
was
time.
Was that a prank?
Well, I was able for the first time to sort of suspend my disbelief and open myself to the point that I could feel something, because I think that what this election has done and what the prospect of these people running our country has done is deadened something beautiful inside me, which is humanity is beautiful and people do the right thing. I mean, I'm almost 47 years old, and my whole life I've been able to maintain that sort of sense of wonder, and I feel like that has dampened because of this, and it prohibits me from being able to sort of let loose in a movie theater and really let myself feel things.
Wow, that is depressing. That's a little sad. Dawn lights on Marblehead.
Let me get this straight, Isabel. You're saying that the Trump election has made it more difficult or easier for you to feel your emotions?
No, she's saying she's less open to the world because she's realized that half of this country are a bunch of freaking lunatics.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I mean, it's
disillusioned you in some sense.
I think you're putting your own spin on that slightly. I like that. Sam's like, I know exactly
why. But that's more or less it, right? I mean, this has been disappointing.
No,
like,
that
how
is
can
it.
So many people overlook? Like, you know, we
so
played a clip of.
Does that make you feel
of,
more empathy for Sam then?
We played a clip the other day of Scott Brown's daughter when she was being asked, like, why she voted for Trump. And she said, well, I was willing to overlook some stuff. You don't say. You're willing to overlook some stuff.
It was even better. She said it was about the
image I can't get out of my head, and it goes to my recommendation later. So I'll say I can't get the image of the Trump sons killing those lions or the beautiful cheetah or whatever it was. I can't get it out of my head, and you know why? Because I think it's like, wait, who did you, everybody saw those images, and yet you still put the weight of your vote behind this. This family? I can't believe it. I can't believe it that people did that.
Isabel, I think then that's a good thing. That's a positive turn of events. If you're able to be disillusioned, that means you were illusioned before. So I think it's probably better that you realize that you are in the minority as far as that opinion goes. Most people,
I
think most people think hunting is great. I think it's the people who don't think it are in the minority.
We're right. It's the bubble people. We're now in the bubble. We're the bubble people.
I'm not sure I accept that assessment. I mean, certainly the numbers don't bear it out.
No pun intended.
Right. Well, or cheetah it out. But Matthew, let me just go back to you. Like, what is it about the election of Trump that makes you think that all of a sudden you're not going to have access to stuff? It's because because commercialism is going to become so rampant. I mean, why do you think that is? Why do you think that is the case?
I can't watch my movies anymore because of Trump. Do you see?
Well, I mean, honestly, like, why do you think that's the case? Because it seems to me, when I think of the most sort of the ascendant era of just like commercialism, I think actually like the late 90s. Which was Bill Clinton, but you tell me. I mean,
such good movies.
Off the top of my head, Sam, I feel like the thing that makes this different is that it basically just it ripped off the final veil that there is any kind of I don't want to say like a value to the lie that you put out there. I mean, he was just so naked in his appeal to the lowest common denominator, to these kind of crass interests, which were always there, true enough. And even, you know, it's not like Hillary Clinton was the bastion of artistic integrity or of some sort of authenticity, far, far from it. But I just feel like there's something so naked and so just the way that the media also basically just ambulance chased him all the way into the White House, you know, just that the whole pretense that news is a public good and not just another place to earn revenue based on whatever gets the most clicks or views. That, I think, has just become completely and totally irredeemably the case. There's no way back, and the only way forward is completely down into a garbage chute of propaganda. So to me, it's about the last vestiges of, like, we have to at least pretend like we're serious. We have to. I mean, they still do, but it's so much less believable, you know, that we are this real cultural gatekeeper of some sort of value.
Shit's getting dark. I hope you have a funny Adam Sandler movie or something like that.
Wait, can I ask a question though? Can I ask a question of you guys in all seriousness?
Of course.
If let's say, because we know that Trump has business all over the planet, and if you are the president, you can't have that, right? So immediately, impeachment proceedings will begin the minute that he
that's not true.
Goes into office.
No, that's not true. First of all,
you need a Congress that's controlled by someone other than the party of the president.
Of course. Well, no, I would say you need a Congress that's controlled by somebody other than the Republicans. I mean, let's face it.
Right.
If the Democrats were doing it, of course they would. Of course, there would be a half a dozen Democratic senators going like, this is absolutely inappropriate for whatever reason.
Yeah.
They would do that. The Republicans are just so craven. No, there's not going to be impeachment hearings.
Well, if there were.
Yeah.
Then here's my question. Let's say he gets impeached. You don't think he's going to do something illegal in like the first 5 minutes? I do.
I think if Donald Trump was to get impeached, it would be because the Republican Party has decided we don't need him anymore, or he's more trouble than he's worth. We'll just have Pence, who's already basically our guy in the White House, just be the guy.
I also think it's going to happen, which is worse.
Well, first of all, I don't think it's worse. I actually think it would be better, because Pence would have to own it in a way that he certainly doesn't now. I mentioned this to Digby on Wednesday's show. I was watching MSNBC. This spent the first 15 minutes of Wednesday night's, 7 o'clock show talking about some dumb tweet argument between him and Bill Clinton. Who gives an F? Like that,
right.
They're literally going through and just agency by agency beginning to plan how they're going to dismantle it. There's so many stories out there.
But Sam, inquiring minds want to know. It's this tabloid thing that just generates views. That's
it. I mean, I get what you're saying, and to a certain extent, it's like it's Donald Trump is sort of the equivalent of going from like the Howard Stern show to one of the guys who's on Howard Stern's show has his own show afterwards on Sirius.
Yeah.
We're watching. We're listening to that show.
We're
listening to that show. We don't get to even watch. We don't get to even listen to Howard Stern's show. We're getting to listen to the intern, Smelly Jeff, the intern show.
Right.
Is basically where we're at now.
Yeah, it's like every time Donald Trump has a press conference, he might as well just say Baba Booey and run out.
But it would be like I get what you're saying.
I'm just saying that, like, we're not even getting the sort of that you can project onto an interesting cultural aspects of this show. It's really just like it's so naked it's really just like the gooey stuff at the bottom of the barrel, essentially.
Yep.
I just didn't realize how much I looked to the. I said this the last time. I sound like a broken record. I didn't realize. Do you know that people aren't even going to get what broken record means? They don't even understand what that means.
I don't know.
You're a corrupted MP3 file.
Yeah. anyway, I didn't realize how much I looked to the presidency. And like on a daily basis, I looked to that whole array of people and the Supreme Court and everybody sort of subconsciously as you are our captain. You will guide us forward. I mean, there were times, of course, that wasn't so good.
Look, I never did that, but that's pretty bad if you're doing that now. You got nowhere to go.
No, you have nothing. Well, at least for 8 years, I've felt like that 100%. I felt so safe.
But did you feel that with Bush? Did you feel that with Bush?
No, I didn't. No, I didn't. But I was so much younger then. I think it's like reading a book every decade. You
get take something different from it.
Yeah, your relationship to certain institutions changes.
I definitely, I think like I, I definitely got in the last two years of the Obama administration, 3 years, like I had moved away from my very apocalyptic worldview that I had had. I mean, it's still somewhat apocalyptic, but my very apocalyptic worldview, like to the point of, you know, after 9/11 in the city, you know, we were told about the gas that was going to come through. And I think I had, like, on September 14th, bought a couple of gas masks. And I probably ultimately used them more for props doing comedy stuff. But I didn't throw them out until, like, like March of this year. And
bad timing.
Well, they probably, I think their efficacy probably
goes down
with
time. You'd
never use
them to scare your kids?
It's just the cartridges. You switch the cartridges.
That would be, is that all it would have taken? That would be a good prank.
Yeah, no, I mean, now I feel like I'm not as worried about
gas. My God, they're not working.
My gas masks are destroyed at just the wrong time.
Why did we check the expiration date?
Well,
all
right. So with all
Trump
this
gonna kill us.
Doom and gloom, ladies and gentlemen, let us...
Wait a minute. It's not. Let me just say, it's not all doom and gloom, because I think I'm adopting that kind of George Carlin feeling of, like, you get it when you're born, you get a ticket to the freak show, and if you're an American, you get a front row seat. So there is still a part of me that's able to kind of watch with a kind of sense of detachment and enjoy just the utter evil and corruption that is happening here, in the hopes that in a possibly reverse sort of backdoor Jimmy Dore kind of ridiculous way does make people come to some understanding of just how screwed everything is, maybe, hopefully, possibly, and to enjoy that process happening.
Yeah.
So there is a silver lining.
But also,
a silver lining.
Also, I feel like my karate kick, which I don't have one, but if I did, is at the ready. Because if anybody came, and we had a trans waiter today, waitress, and whatever, I was, you know, because here's the thing. If anybody came and tried to, like, hurt her or, like, I don't know this person, right? But she's very clearly a man dressed as a woman, whatever. There was some kind of LGBT thing going on there. Someone tried to hurt them or bully them. I would, like, I feel like before I would try and use my words, and now I feel like I would beat the shit out of them.
Whoa.
Now I'd be like, don't you mess with that person? And like,
that's the darkest development we've noted. So
no,
far.
I think that sense of, like, there's a certain solidarity, I think, that is that I think is healthy. I mean,
Well, and there's been so much violence. You can't help it. You watch every single day at these rallies and you know, and they're talking because they're running for president. What's it called? A campaign. What's it called?
A presidential campaign.
Yeah, whatever. You know, and these people yelling and being violent, and then it gets into you. And I feel like before I would be an advocate for saying, let's sit down and talk about this like Obama would. And now I'm in this much more sort of,
you know,
like,
what you need to
I'll
do?
Punch you in the nose.
You need to get a pepper spray or a stunning. Just pepper spray people.
And just be like, it's a prank.
Yeah. Spray first, ask questions later.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm not advocating violence, but I just feel like everything's all tumbled.
The unfortunate thing is that this does bring you into that feeling, and I feel it too. You know, I'm a freelance worker. I don't have what you would call job security except for what I can hustle, and it's unfortunate that the system is kept alive by a pervasive sense of the need for individual survival strategies. That's what Noam Chomsky always called it, and I think it really works out. It explains it well. You get this sense of, like, all right, everything else is screwed, but I'm going to protect me and mine. And I'm
right.
Gonna rally, yeah. The circle the
I got mine, boys.
I'm,
pull up the ladder. Yeah.
And that's exactly the opposite impulse that you need to actually combat the forces that are keeping you there. So it's a cycle.
Right. And you know what? It's messed up my parenting, too, because I was getting tickets for one of our kids, a rock show coming, like some show coming up. And I was like, wow. He's, you know, 12 or whatever, so I'm going to get him in the nosebleeds because no young kid should have good seats. And then I was like, you know what? Uh-uh. Now we need to get the good seats. See it while you can, because God knows what's coming.
That's interesting. I see what you're saying.
You know, have a root beer. Who cares?
Another drink. Drink at work. Why not?
I mean, I've got to concede. I have allowed. I have been thinking about drinking, day drinking, a lot more.
Have you been thinking? You haven't. Okay. I misinterpreted some of your actions recently. My mistake.
I have been thinking about day drinking a lot more.
Make a packy rondeau.
And I've stopped really engaging with Saul. I'm just like,
yeah, you can't raise two kids in this.
It's
crisis.
Just sort of like, you know what, buddy? I'm not. Why am I going to try and intellectually stimulate?
I'm sorry. I should have done it. I mean, this is totally responsible.
I understand what you're saying. I mean, I think there is a sort of. I mean, that is like. That's, I mean, what you've just expressed is sort of like the mentality of The Walking Dead, really, on some level. Like,
yeah.
It depends on where you are in the arc of the show. But that's what they constantly combat, this notion of, like, I've just got to survive and lose my sense of community. And it's not until they come to the realization that, like, that's not how you survive. You survive via the community. This is an interesting I don't want to go down this path because I want to hear your movie selections, but what is the name of that Adam Curtis film?
Hypernormalization
is
that's incredible.
Touches on this notion of like art becoming too individualized and it becoming depoliticized because it is about individuality. And and there's also, you know, a lot of like sort of arguments as to whether or not this is sort of, you know, part of the result of a neoliberal project, right, where you have to have your core brand proposition, Michael.
Is the requirement of capitalism.
Yes. And particularly if you're going to brand that self. But let's not get into that now because hopefully we're going to talk to Curtis in the new year.
Them both back on brand.
Maybe, yes. Okay. So being back on brand and also maintain the integrity of the branding of this segment.
Let me get my beret. Okay.
we have our film recommendations. I put no parameters on this. It could be about the best film of last year or the film that you need to watch to deal with next year. Who would like to go first? Oh, wait a second, Matt.
Age before beauty.
Hold on, wait a second. Let me repeat that. Who would like to go first?
Wait a minute. Age before beauty. Am I older or younger than you?
Wait. What? All right. What? Who wants to go first?
I'll go first. I don't understand. Am I older than you or younger than you?
You're both.
You're slightly older, but hey, let's not quibble.
Older.
I'm older.
Good Lord. Well, I mean that speaks to also Matt's lack of beauty.
No.
What? The fact that he obviously just looked at his Twitter avatar.
All right, hold on.
He's old before his time.
Not good.
All right, I will go first. Sad. Hold on, just for a second.
What are you doing?
Because my kid just came home from school.
Okay.
Well, I don't have any kids.
I'm on live radio. Okay. Goodbye.
Not really.
Tell me you're talking to Hugo.
Sorry. I was saying goodbye. I'm on the radio.
Hello,
radio.
Isabel's child.
Everybody just got
it's
home.
Hugo.
Everybody just got home from school. One
fell swing.
It's all over, kids. Have a root beer.
How was your day at school?
Go help yourself to any kind of sweets you want.
That's really true. That's what I say.
Watch some TV. Who gives a shit?
I'm like, it's all over. Get yourself a ring ding. Okay. Have a ring ding. Go to, let's eat some Entenmann's. Okay.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Okay. So in thinking about the apocalypse, no, this is what I thought. I'm not going backwards on this year because it's too weird to go back into such a sort of traumatic
right.
Year. So
good
we're going to go forward.
That's what we should all do.
But it is something that I watch repeatedly for a sense of calm and a sense of this is a big something's bigger than me or my apartment or my block or my city or my state kind of goes big, okay? And it's documentary, and everybody can watch it. And since it's the holiday time, everybody can watch it with their family. It's on Netflix, and it is a documentary series called Planet Earth.
Planet Earth. You've talked about this in the past, and it's very
interesting. No, I haven't.
You have, years ago.
Have I?
Yes. But no, that's good. I mean, it's
been
so long
that
you didn't.
But it wasn't on Netflix.
It wasn't on Netflix.
It wasn't on Netflix a long time ago.
And this is great for the kids, too.
It's amazing. And when, and I'm not kidding, when the kids, when it's kind of like, let's watch something, but it's a school night, but I don't want you to watch, you know, something stupid, or
really?
I don't want you to be on
because
your computer by yourself.
Because it doesn't matter anymore, right?
I know, but yeah. I don't want them to be on their computers by themselves. I want to watch something together. And the only thing they really want to watch with me is Planet Earth, because it's all over the place. So you could go be with a polar bear and then an ice cap and then down into something ancient.
Well, I mean, presumably the polar bear is near the ice cap.
Yeah, well, but I'm saying it's not like 2 hours on a polar bear. So it moves and it's although I could watch 2 hours on happily on a polar bear. Mm. It's breathtaking. It's ancient and what we need to think about, but it's family friendly, but you can kind of be mesmerized by it. I find it a sort of go-to of a sense of bigger than yourself, like to get out of your own belly button. This is what I go to, and it's not like seeing a narrative of, you know, a story of fiction where you're, you know, sometimes when I watch fiction, I think, oh, maybe I should have done that, or how come I can't write like that, or I should make a movie. It's like, this is sort of bigger than that, and you're like, oh, let's get really deep into a pine tree or into a fjord, or it's just, I love it so much.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's good. I mean, if it wasn't for the horrible specter of global warming.
That isn't what she needs, man.
No, I know. Yeah. But nevertheless, still, it's important and it's grounding and, you know, it's...
And maybe you go fight for it. I don't know. It's like the only thing I could think of that's... No, don't be funny. Maybe you go and, you know, maybe it is global because there is a sting. There is a sting with it. But there's a sting with everything.
That's right. That's right. Everything is going to be just a little bit less good.
Oof.
I mean, what are you going to do? I mean, it's not, you know, we also got to, we also have to realize that we're still better off than the vast majority in the world.
That is certainly true. This isn't Aleppo.
All
this
right,
goes
well,
to 62 countries, though.
Planet Earth. And so how many shows is that? I mean, how
it's
many episodes?
So many.
Oh, great.
It's so many. They're like 20 of them. But you see, you know, you would see herds of wildebeest running across the Serengeti, like thousands and thousands of them. You see things that you can't even believe are true, and it's there it all is. And the camera work's amazing. You can go inside like an ant's, you know, lair. It's just so cool. You can go inside a hibernating bear's cave. I don't know how they get there.
Mm.
It's amazing. It's amazing filmmaking. That's what I got.
All right. I love it. That's actually, that's great because that's what I'm going to have Saul watch all next week.
Oh. Oh yeah, you are.
I'm serious.
The next 4 years.
Exactly.
No, I'm serious too.
I'm
and
serious.
Myla, and look, my kids are 15. My 15-year-old loves it. And he loved it when he was younger.
Yeah, I don't know if Myla will, but
yes,
we'll
she will.
Well,
yes, right. She will. That's the beauty of this. She will.
All right. Sold. Oh, unless I got to tell you, we watched Captain Fantastic.
Isn't that a great movie?
And
that's great.
Myla did not want to watch it because she gets too emotionally involved.
Well, that's
and
pretty big.
Yeah. And but at the end, even though she, you know, it was obviously it's very heart-wrenching, she loved it. We loved the movie.
Oh, yeah.
Such a
so
good
job on that one.
That is such a
thank
good movie.
Thank you.
All right. Now, let us hear from Matthew Film Guy. Matthew Film Guy, give us your assessment, Planet Earth, up or down? Thumbs up or thumbs down?
Oh, nature, thumbs up. Who doesn't love nature?
There you go. All right, so let's hear.
Even if it is through the artificial light on a two-dimensional screen inside your heated and air-conditioned home. But still, the closest
well,
you can get is
unbelievable,
fine by me.
Right?
Hard to get there otherwise, just saying.
Yeah, absolutely. But, you know, communing with nature, that's probably something good to do these days, too. Get unplugged, get out there, actually touch a tree. I mean, I've heard. That's not what I do, but I've heard that.
All right. Well, come on. Let's hear it.
Let's hear it. So, all right. So here's my rallying cry for the last vestiges of anything resembling film culture. I think everyone should go back and watch the final film by the spiritually transcendent French filmmaker Robert Bresson. And he made it in 1983, and it is called L'Argent. And
Officer.
No, it means money.
Oh, money. Sorry.
And
wrong.
It basically encapsulates some of the issues that we touched on here today about business values and money being the transcendent value in society, and it doesn't do it in a way that is
gendarme.
Creepy. There you go, Sam. Very good.
Thank you.
Very good. You finally got it.
All right, I'm sorry. So yeah.
That's okay. I'm always happy to indulge you in your feeling that you know French. I think that's an important part of your personality.
Merci beaucoup.
But it's basically about a teenager who passes off a counterfeit bill and the sort of string of calamities that ensues. And it kind of follows the bill that changes hands. But
ooh, I love that.
It's done in Bresson's extremely aesthetic, kind of distancing, formal way, and it is extremely subtle. He always cast non-professional actors. He called them his models, if you're familiar with Bresson's work. He always had them be basically as abstract as possible so they weren't sort of chewing the scenery. And the effect that it has on the audience is that you're really drawn in because you really have to pay close attention to what's happening because everybody's behavior is kind of artificial. But it is extremely scathing in its sort of condemnation of, I mean, he was a devout Catholic, so he has a kind of a spiritual condemnation, but it kind of works in our current, I don't know what you call it, debased environment where someone like Donald Trump is elected simply because he has so much money, essentially, and it kind of looks at the root of all evil, so to speak, being this ability to abstract human interactions into a commodity. And it's an unforgiving film. It's not even
that's very situationist, I should say, as well.
Perhaps. You know, he was a little bit older than those people, but Bresson was also a big inspiration to the new French New Wave in the 60s. But this is his final film in 1983, and it is just as searing and as powerful a document as any of the other movies he made, like The Pickpocket or
I saw The Pickpocket.
Man Escapes. You know, some of these are film school kind of requirements, but
yeah,
L'Argent is equally as devastating, and I think it's just appropriate, and it kind of makes you have to tune your frequencies into something a little less sort of blunt than a political screed, but it is there, and it's an extremely affecting movie. So if you can find it, go out and get Robert Bresson's L'Argent. Tune into it. Turn off the lights. Don't take any phone calls. Try to just sit with it and let it take you over. It took me a few times seeing it to really crack it, but it is worth the effort.
And, I mean, that is almost like the last thing you hear on that sort of Doppler effect is someone is like, it's the last sound. As someone just sort of falls and you hear that's what it sounds like you're offering up. Like this is the last thing into the long good night.
This is my impression of Sam watching that movie.
Hello. Hold on. Let me put the movie down. You want to talk about Social Security?
No,
shut up.
I'll be tweeting out.
You're totally wrong about Pennsylvania.
Right. Exactly.
This is a good movie. just called him
Robert
officer.
Brisson L'Argent. How does that sound to you, Isabel?
Well, it sounds great. And I love the idea of the dollar or whatever it was, a franc, getting passed for a counterfeit money from one person to another and how that affects the whoever is the receiver of the – I love that. I love stories like that. I love stories about, like, there was once a story about a desk that you followed all the way through the centuries. I love stuff like that. However, I do not – I can't – I don't think I could crack it. I don't think I have three or four times to see it.
Well, it's actually only 80 minutes long, so maybe you could.
Yeah, well, maybe I could if I was really concentrating.
It's definitely a movie that benefits from being in a theater where you don't have, like, the kids bugging you and things to kind of distract you from it. But
right. Well, actually, I think
it's
that
kind
in
of
this...
a crime story, you know, so it's got elements, the genre elements that are not necessarily, like, super sort of, you know, abstract. So
and
it
listen,
has...
listen.
Hold on.
I'm always sort of doing – I like – you know, we recommend different kinds of movies. But I'll tell you something. In this day and age, I think we have to fine-tune our paying attention mojo. Like, we have to get – we have to be really able to concentrate and watch something through a number of different passes so that we can catch it, right? Because we've
That's
gotten
my
dumbed
core
down.
Brand proposition, Isabel.
That's what?
That's my core brand proposition for sure.
Well,
yeah.
Now that we've come full circle, ladies and gentlemen, where we have come back again to core brand propositions.
You didn't think that would stick when
our
I started defense. Talking about that, did you?
We have commodified our, this show is like a commodification of the dissent, right? I mean,
listen,
on some level,
I'm sitting here eating my Sherry's berries and my Omaha steaks and my blue apron, and I'm shaving with my Harry's and watching CISO and getting a soothe massage. So yeah, what's wrong with that?
Jeez.
And then
wow.
I might do a find someone on ZipRecruiter later.
Yeah, exactly. You what do? You just you posted yourself on the places to be found on ZipRecruiter.
Yeah, exactly.
All right. Well,
so thanks.
I'm going to go make butternut squash soup and stay in that lane again.
Well, then you might enjoy the Gourmet Magazine opportunity we have for you at gourmet.com/GA.
What?
I don't, is that
Fine
what it is?
Gourmet
I,
Magazine.
Oh, Bon Appetit.
Bon Appetit.
Bon Appetit.
Is a
not Bon Appetit. Gourmet is the, like with the dodo bird.
Oh, forget that. Okay, yeah. Bon Appetit is what I'm
Yeah, Bon Appetit. He doesn't
Much
know
better magazine.
About. Yeah.
Well, you could read it on texture
food.
If you wanted
you could,
to.
Yeah, you could also read it on texture, which will give you a whole set of magazines.
Isabel, Matthew Film Guy, you guys have been an integral part of this program for at least half a decade. It's terrifying,
wow, that's
isn't
crazy.
It?
Crazy.
It's insane. But
so proud.
I
so
want
proud.
To.
I am so proud too.
I want to thank you. And as we move into this era of a little bit less hope and a little bit more about opposition and dissent,
vigilance.
We're going to need moments of art and levity. And expanding ourselves culturally.
Root beer.
And
root beer.
F it. It's all
F
gonna,
it. Doesn't matter.
But
get strawberries.
I can't thank you guys enough for being part of this program. It is, I know our audience loves it, but it's always so much fun for me, and I need it. By the end of the week, I need it. And even when I don't watch the movies you recommend, although off the top of my head, like even just talking to you, I see images of the movies that have really resonated with me, like the Killing Elite. Then I ended
Elite
up watching
Squad, you mean?
Elite Squad, and then
Great
I watched
movies.
Narcos because of that, and I just even recently Captain Fantastic or The Wire, or I don't know, these all just jump into my head. So I thank you so much for this, because literally this is the extent of my cultural exposure now.
Captain Fantastic is so good, man. I
so,
keep
so happy
so
to do
good.
It, Sam. Really my pleasure. I love the show. I love what you guys do. And if I could help you in even a small way, I feel gratified.
All right. Well, thanks, guys. We'll see
God,
you.
Me too. I can't tell you how attached I feel to the show and to the to the audience and to the whole Twitter scene, and to and I feel like it's an opportunity that I would have never guessed, and I'm so grateful for it.
All right, guys. Well, have a great Christmas and Hanukkah and spaghetti holiday that you celebrate,
see you,
Michael. And a great New Year.
Hopefully.
See you in 2017. Yeah, exactly. See you guys in 2017. All right, guys.
Peace.
So long.
Peace.
Bye, Isabel. Bye, Sam.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Lots of love.
Bye. All right, folks. That is our program, our final new program for 2017. I mean, 2016. Oh, Jesus. We just skipped a whole year.
I like that. The whole year of the administration off for us. Thank you.
I mean, we'll say our more heartfelt goodbyes tomorrow, because it'll be live tomorrow, yes. Which is actually yesterday. I don't want to mess you guys up, but we're going to be live yesterday. And so if you missed that, then go back where I said my goodbyes and thank yous for the year. So next week, we have 5 days of programming for you. Best of shows this week. We've got stuff that is actually pretty evergreen from this year, talking about authoritarians, talking about organizing, talking about white rage, talking about the Koch brothers, talking about the congressional elections. We talk about a lot of different things that I think will have relevance looking backwards, going forward, without having through the year anticipated that Donald Trump would be the president. And
that would be a very a humbling, heartbreaking montage of us being like, I mean, okay, he's not going to win. But here's the breakdown.
Right. And members are going to get some deep archive stuff. We're also going to have some fun moments from the year, the comedy that will make you cry. There's a lot of crapping on Jeb Bush, because that seems like the safest. That seems like terra firma.
That does seem like, I don't know how bad can these guys be. I mean, the Jeb material is pretty good.
Exactly. And it's not like anybody's going to go like, oh, look at you laughing at Jeb Bush. How wrong were you? No, actually, that was the
nailed
one.
Nailed it.
That was one thing we got right. So
we nailed the least important prediction of the year.
Exactly. That's exactly right. We got the most inconsequential stuff right. So with that, become a member of the Majority Report and support more future getting it wrong for just pennies a day. You can have us getting it wrong every single day of
getting
the year.
It wrong smugly.
Exactly.
For pennies a day.
You can go to jointhemajorityreport.com. As always, just coffee.coop, fair trade coffee, tea, or check. Ah, screw it. I'm not even going to do all that. We've got, and we will be back on January 2nd or 3rd, I believe it is. Whatever that Tuesday is. So, 3rd, January 3rd, live. But check out our best of shows. You're going to love them, folks. And we'll see you then. Have a great, great, great New Year. But I'll have said this yesterday, which will be actually in real time tomorrow, but for you, yesterday. Goodbye.
It might take all the strength I got to get to where I want, but I know somehow I'm gonna get there. I wasn't